Good morning. Welcome to another edition of Inspirational Wednesdays. My name is Pastor Al Kennon. It's my pleasure. It's my privilege. It's my honor to be here today to facilitate this prayer conference call. You don't know how much it means to me to be able to sit here and pray for you, to be able to petition the Lord God Almighty on your behalf, to be able to lift up what you're going through, what you're dealing with, knowing that not only is God going to answer the prayer, oh, I have no doubt, he's going to answer the prayer, but he's going to show you just how powerful he is. He's going to show you just how incredible and amazing he is. And he's going to prove to the world that he still sits on the throne. He still does what only he could do. He is still in control. Amen. And so I am just excited about what God is going to do this morning in our midst. I believe he's going to do something incredible, something amazing, something wonderful for us. And I believe that we are in for an incredible experience. Amen. Amen. So let's do this. Let's do this. Amen. This is a prayer conference call. Let's go ahead. Amen. And open up with a word of prayer. Amen. Praise God. Trying to make sure that we are good here. Amen. On my computer. All right. Let's open up with a word of prayer. Then we're going to get busy. We're going to jump into our devotional this morning. We have a good one. Amen. Praise God. Then we'll jump to our devotional, and then we'll move into the prayer section of our call. I swear, these computers, they have a mind of their own. Amen. But we're trusting the Spirit of God to get us through, to bring us through. So here, let us have our opening word of prayer. Dear Lord God, thank you for your grace and your mercy. Thank you, God, for loving us as you have. In fact, God, we are rejoicing, for today is the day that you are made. We are glad about it. We are happy about it. God, thank you for watching over us for the past 7 days. It's been 7 days since we came together, God, for prayer, praise, and devotion. And God, in that time, a lot has happened. In that time, we have grown. In that time, we've lost. In that time, we've acquired. In that same time, God, you have done what only you could do. And God, it has been a learning experience. It has been a learning curve. And God, we are here asking you, praying to you, requesting God that you will continue to keep your hands of grace, mercy, love, and kindness all upon us. That God, you would continue to shine your favor down upon us. That you would continue, God, to choose us, and not just choose us, but to be proud of us, to declare that we are your people, in whom, God, you are well pleased. God, someone this morning is looking for you, and we pray, God, that whoever's looking for you, God, that they would find you, that they would experience you, that they would understand, God, how perfect and how awesome you really are. Now, Father God, we pray as we come together for this prayer conference call that God, everyone is on one accord, that your Holy Spirit rests, rule, and abides on this call, that you give us the sympathy and the empathy necessary to be able to lift the prayer requests of your children. And that God, through it all, you be praised, you be glorified, you would be honored, God. God, we are loving you, we're thanking you, we are praising you, we are exalting you. Because God, the truth is, you are amazing. Yes, you are. So God, again, do what only you can do. It's in your Son's mighty, matchless, marvelous, and magnificent name that we do pray. Amen. Amen, everyone. Amen. Praise God. If you have your Bibles, would you please turn with me to the book of Acts. Amen. Our scriptorial focus this morning comes from Acts chapter 9. Verses 10 through 19, Acts chapter 9, verses 10 through 19. Amen. Praise God. The New Revised Standard Version of the scripture reads as follows. Now there was a disciple in Damascus named Ananias. Christ Jesus said to him in a vision, Ananias, he answered, here I am, Lord. The Lord said to him, get up and go to the street called Straight, and at the house of Judas, look for a man of Tarsus named Saul. At this moment, he is praying, and he has seen in a vision a man named Ananias come in and lay his hands on him so that he might regain his sight. But Ananias answered, Lord, I heard from many about this man, how much evil he has done to your saints in Jerusalem. And here he has authority from the chief priests to bind all who invoke your name. But Jesus said to him, go, for Saul is an instrument whom I have chosen to bring my name before Gentiles and kings and before the people of Israel. I myself will show him how much he must suffer for the sake of my name. So Ananias went and entered the house. He laid his hands on Saul and said, Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus who appeared to you on your way here has sent me so that you may regain your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit. And immediately something like scales fell from Saul's eyes and his sight was restored. Then he got up and was baptized. And after taking some food, Saul regained his strength. Thus far, the word of God. Amen. The title of our devotional this morning is Humility, Ministering to Those Persons Who Have Deadly Intentions for You. Humility, ministering to those persons who have deadly intentions for you. You know, there are a lot of persons that claim to be followers of Christ Jesus. And these would-be followers have been overheard declaring that they would do anything for the resurrected Son of the Most High God. Anything he commanded them to say is what they would say. Anything he instructed them to do is what they would do. And any place he required them to go is where they would go. Yet, we literally witness time and time again that there are some statements these individuals aren't willing to say. There are some things that they aren't willing to do, and there are some places they aren't willing to go. We've seen it. God has told us to say certain things to certain people, and we didn't want to say it because we were afraid of hurting their feelings. Yet you would do anything for the Lord God Almighty. There's some things God has asked you to do, but no, you ain't doing that because that's beneath you. Yet there's anything you would do. You said you'd go any place, but guess what? You ain't going there. I know that we don't ever want to believe this about ourselves or about anyone in particular. We sincerely want to believe that we, as well as the people connected to us, are as faithful as we believe ourselves to be. But there is that one particular discipleship assignment that crosses the line for us, for many of us. There's that one specific stewardship obligation that asks too much for us. Say what we want, but the truth is that we aren't as willing to serve the Lord as we assert. There's no need for any of us to get into our feelings this morning. Instead, we might as well be honest with ourselves and the God we serve. Despite our protestations to the contrary, our willingness to serve the great I Am isn't as limitless as we claim it is. Case in point is Brother Ananias. He was a believer that lived in Damascus. Clearly, he was an early adopter of the Christian faith. He likely considered himself to be a devout, faithful follower of Christ Jesus and a strong adherent to Jesus' teachings. I think that I'm safe in saying that until the events of Acts chapter 9, Brother Ananias probably believed that there was nothing that the Lord God Almighty, his Son, Christ Jesus, and his blessed Holy Spirit could ask him to do that he wouldn't readily do. I think we can confidently say that this was Ananias' thinking, and honestly, it should have been. Who can call himself or herself a follower of Christ Jesus who has explicit reservations beforehand about serving him exactly as he requires? Every believer, from Brother Ananias down to each of us today, sincerely believes that if our Heavenly Father requires us to do anything in particular, we would quickly and eagerly complete this assignment, thereby accomplishing whatever divine objective undergirds such assignment. But how often are any of us called to minister to those persons that have deadly intentions for us? When is the last time the Lord our God required any of us black folks to travel to those paramilitary camps set up and operated by white supremacists and minister to these very individuals? We know exactly who I'm talking about and where these persons can be found. Those same violence-spewing, race-baiting, and hate-filled individuals who have located themselves on the outskirts of most metropolitan centers and live in undeveloped or underdeveloped rural areas. Those white supremacists. Here's a question I put to us this morning. When we were given this assignment, if the Lord God Almighty has assigned us this ministry task, how many of us immediately and eagerly completed it? Huh? Not very many of us, right? In fact, I think I can confidently say that none of us black folks have remotely attempted to complete this assignment. That's because we already know that these white supremacists have murderous intentions for black people and other minorities in America. The last thing that any of us black folks are going to do is to provide these same white supremacists with any easy targets of senseless violence. It doesn't matter what anyone says or think, and that it really doesn't matter what anyone says and think, and that includes all of us here right now, okay? Again, don't take issue with me. I'm just calling it like it is. Very few of us, arguably none of us, are willing to engage in ministry that threatens our lives. There's no need for us to sit here this morning and tell that lie. But this type of ministry assignment is a very discipleship assignment that Christ Jesus laid at Brother Ananias' feet. He instructed his follower to travel literally into the lion's den to minister to Saul, who was renowned for his murderous intentions toward first century Christians. And what we observe from Brother Ananias is a demonstrated humility that many of us are both incapable and unwilling to emulate or replicate. Yet the great I Am declares this morning that if we're going to be the Christian disciples and the stewards, Christian disciples and stewards that he requires us to be, then this is the type of humility we must possess and we must exercise. Our first point to our devotional this morning is this: our discipleship assignments and stewardship obligations are not conditioned upon our personal wishes and desires. They are instead based upon the explicit will of the Lord God Almighty. Let me say that again. Our discipleship assignments and stewardship obligations are not conditioned upon our personal wishes and desires. They are instead based upon the explicit will of the Lord God Almighty. Please allow God our Father to provide us with the background to Brother Ananias' discipleship requirement. Saul had recently received papers from the Jewish high priest authorizing him, Saul, to travel to Damascus and to arrest any person that openly and publicly declared that Jesus was both the Son and Messiah of the living God. This was especially true for any Jewish person. If any Hebrew declared that Jesus was the Son and Messiah of the Lord, then Saul was authorized to arrest that individual. And if that person resisted arrest, Saul was also authorized to use deadly force. This wasn't the first time that Saul had been authorized to operate in this manner. Rather, it was just the latest incident. And because this was the latest incident, Saul had developed a well-earned reputation for being violent and malevolent. His reputation preceded him wherever he went. First century Christians were justified in fearing him. Brother Ananias was no exception to this fear. He too feared Saul and what Saul could do to him, his friends and family, and other believers. Therefore, when Christ Jesus instructed Ananias to go to Judas's house and minister to Saul, his concerns about this discipleship assignment were well-founded. I think we're all safe in saying that if Brother Ananias had his druthers, he did not want this ministry assignment. He did not want to be anywhere Saul was, and he definitely did not want to be the one who was required to minister to Saul. But what we notice is that the Lord above didn't make this assignment based on what Brother Ananias wanted or desired. Instead, he made this assignment because he had explicit intentions for Saul. It was imperative that his will was realized in this situation. Therefore, our God assigned this specific task to Ananias. Let this truth be informative for us this morning. The Lord our God has a specific purpose that he wishes to accomplish in the lives of the people within our individual spheres and circles of influence. He wants to reach them, but that's not all. He also wants to pull them into the kingdom where they can serve him like we do. Therefore, our God is less concerned with what it is we personally desire than he is with accomplishing his will. Let me tell you something. Every Christian Christian disciple and steward, when we came into this thing called ministry, came into this walk called faith, we all have personal desires about what we wanted to do for God and how we wanted to do it and where we wanted to do it and who we wanted to do it with and why we want. We all had our own personal desires. Can't tell you how many times I've heard ministers talk about how they intend to preach before thousands of people across the earth, across the planet, across the world. Amen. How they're going to be leaders of this change, that change. Every one of us has been there. That's been our personal desire. But here's the funny thing. There are times when our personal desires do not line up with God's will. God doesn't always want every one of us to preach to thousands of people. Someone's got to preach to the one, the two, the five, the 10, the 20, the 100. Every one of us can't minister on a global scale. Someone has to minister right there in that rundown, dilapidated, neglected community. Everyone can't be the next this, the next Garner T. Teller, the next T.D. Jakes, the next Billy Curtis. Someone just has to be who they are. And here's the thing. God is not worried about how you want to serve him. He's worried about his will being accomplished. And if that means he has to use you in ways that you don't necessarily want to be used, then so be it. Here's the problem. You got up there in the church singing to him, "Use me as you want to use me." You sang that song. You made the declaration that he could use you as he wanted to use you. Therefore, don't get mad. If God decides to use you in a way that does not line up with your personal desire or your wishes. In fact, that's a sign of spiritual immaturity, that you are bent out of shape because God has taken you in a direction opposite or contrary to what you want to go for ministry. Yeah. That's a telltale sign. A spiritual immaturity. Get over it. He's not here to serve you. We're here to serve him. And that means if anyone's personal desires have to be put on the altar to sacrifice, it's going to be ours. Our first point this morning is our discipleship assignments and stewardship obligations are not conditioned upon our personal wishes and desires. They are instead based upon the explicit will of the Lord God Almighty. Amen. Our second point this morning is this. The Lord God Almighty's explicit will is that these very enemies become our brothers and sisters in faith and co-laborers in ministry. Let me say it again. The Lord God Almighty's explicit will is that these very enemies become our brothers and sisters in faith and co-laborers in ministry. Please don't misunderstand our God here. He is not cold, nor is he inconsiderate of what we think or feel about anything or anyone at any given moment in our lives. No, he is well aware that these persons have inflicted and are capable of inflicting great harm and distress in our lives. He gets what we currently feel. He understands exactly where we're coming from. But as we touched on in the first point of this devotional, the issue isn't about what we personally feel or believe about the subject nature of our discipleship assignments and stewardship obligations. Rather, the issue is solely about accomplishing God's will. That's it. That's all that matters. That is what is on the table as we serve him spiritually. Brother Ananias saw and understood Saul merely as a tormentor, torturer, and enemy of the church. But that's not how the great I am saw and understood Saul. He also saw Saul as Paul. He understood that Paul would be one of his greatest servants. Through Paul, the Christian faith would be disseminated in ways that were unfathomable to Brother Ananias in that moment. 75% of what we call today the New Testament was going to be produced by the same mind and the same hands that tormented and harassed first century Christians. Because this is how our Heavenly Father saw and understood Saul, then it was imperative that his will was accomplished. He didn't have time for Brother Ananias to be in his feelings about this assignment. Instead, he needed Ananias to get on his page and get busy ministering to Paul. Let me say this to some of us here today, this morning. The very person that you hate, that you despise, that you can't stand, that works your nerve,
that gets under your skin,
the very person that fits that bill is likely the very person that God is going to require you to minister to. You want to know why? Because God's intention is that all would be saved. Not just me, not just your mama, not just your daddy, not just your brother, not just your sister, not just your boo, not just your sweet thing, not just bae. All of us would be saved. And when all, we say all, we mean all. Therefore, the very person that you can't stand, the very person that works your nerve, the very person that gets under your skin, God intends for that person to become your brother or your sister in ministry and in faith and a co-laborer in ministry. Ananias took issue with going to minister to Saul because Ananias could only see Saul as he was. Many of us are taking issue with who we have to minister to because we can only see the people that we're required to minister to as they are. We can't see them in the future. We don't know how God is going to use them, who he's going to make them into being. And here we are, we get our panties in a bind because God is telling us to go minister to Rashinka, to go minister to Lakeisha, to go minister to Hassan, to go minister to Bobo, to go minister to Junebug, to go minister to Tiny. And we in our feelings because we can't stand them. But guess what? Ain't about who you can stand. It's about God's will. And God's will is that they would become brothers and sisters in faith and co-laborers in ministry. That means me and you, we got to get over what we personally feeling. Because we could be hindering.
In fact, let me not get on my next point. Amen. That's my next point. Come on.
We could be hindering someone from serving God as God requires.
In fact, let me review my points. Let's get into my next point because I just jumped right into it. Our first point, our discipleship assignments and stewardship obligations are not conditioned upon our personal wishes and desires. They are instead based upon the explicit will of the Lord God Almighty. Our second point, the Lord God Almighty's explicit will is that these very enemies become our brothers and sisters in faith and co-laborers in ministry. Our third point this morning is sometimes the best ways to demonstrate faith is to exercise obedient humility before the Lord God Almighty. Sometimes the best way to demonstrate faith is to exercise obedient humility before the Lord God Almighty. Brother Ananias had a choice to make that day some 2,000 years ago. Either he could be arrogant and choose not to be obedient to Christ Jesus, or he could humble himself and demonstrate obedience to the express will and commandment of the Lord. Brother Ananias chose the latter. He chose to humble himself before God and be obedient to the assignment given to him. He went to Judas's house and ministered to Saul as our Heavenly Father required. As a direct result of Ananias' obedient humility, Saul himself was encouraged to trust Christ Jesus and to serve him as he required. What persons within our circles and spheres of influence does the Lord God Almighty want to use for his glory? Who has he destined to become the next Paul or Pauline? Whoever this individual is, the truth remains that he or she cannot become the Christian leader that they're destined to be if we don't first exercise obedient humility as God's Christian disciples and stewards. Beloved, this really ain't about us. It really isn't. It's about these other persons and the Lord's will for their lives. What we must do is to exercise some faith in the Lord our God. We must trust that if the Lord has required us to step inside of the lion's den, he has already addressed the dangers located within such den. We have to stop worrying about what dangers will befall us when we step foot into the lion's den. Rather, we should operate with the belief that God our Father will protect us from both dangers seen and unseen in these lairs. Our focus shouldn't be on what will happen to us if we serve the Lord as he requires. Instead, it should be on what will happen to the people we have been assigned to minister to when we exercise obedient humility. Look, let me ask you a question. What dangers exist that the great I am cannot handle? Think about that. What dangers exist? What threats, what challenges, what predicaments, what tribulations, what trials, what troubles exist that the Lord our God cannot handle? Do you realize every single day you came just that close to dying? You have no clue how many bullets flew right by you. You think you say because you didn't hear it, you didn't see it, you didn't know it. You have no clue how many times you've come that close to being in an accident that wasn't just going to hurt you, but was going to kill you. You know, you don't know how many times you've literally walked the line of something unfortunate happening to you. And now you want to trip out because the discipleship assignment and the stewardship obligation requires you to minister to someone that you can now see the danger? I know the old saying, ignorance is bliss. I get it. But here, what we have to get is that if God kept us, in spite of what we didn't see, couldn't see, didn't know to see, how much more will he keep us here in these situations? No, I'm not telling you to be stupid, not telling you to be unwise, not telling you to be foolish. But what I am telling you is that if God has told you that he needs you to do certain things, you need to get your rooter tooter up and go do it. Stop tripping over what could happen. In fact, no, trip over what could happen. What could happen if this person gave themselves to God and actually started serving God as God requires? What could happen if this person went where he or she was sent and ministered to the people that he or she were required to minister to?
We talking about who the next Paul, who the next Peter, who's the next James, who's the next John, who's the next Moses, who's the next David, who's the next Solomon. There are a whole lot of people. Who's the next Deborah? Who's the next Mary? Who's the next Mary of Magdalene? Who's the next Samaritan woman at the well? We don't know who's God next. But our God does. He knows exactly who's God next. And because he knows who's God next. Could it be that God is waiting for us to go minister so that whoever's got nets can get nets, be nets, do nets?
The truth is, there are no troubles that the Lord God Almighty cannot overcome. None. And since there are none, we must stop allowing our fears to overwhelm our faith. We are called to glorify our God, and that happens when we utilize our humility to enable us to serve him by faith. Amen. Amen. Let's do this. Let's, amen, have a word of prayer over our devotional here this morning. Amen. Praise God. And then we're going to move into the prayer section of our call where we get to hear from you. Amen. So, with that said, let's pray over our devotional right quick. Dear Father God, creator of the heavens and the earth, thank you for this day, for this is the day that you have made, God. We are glad. We are rejoicing in it. Father God, you spoke to us through this devotional. And really, God, you address humility from the perspective of putting aside what we want and serving you as you require. Yes, humility is not thinking more of ourselves than we should, but it's also putting aside what we want to do, what we want to possess, what we want to have, so that your will may be done. Our greatest example of that is Jesus, for he wanted that cup to pass from him, but he realized it was not what he wanted, but what you wanted that mattered in the end. And so, God, help us to understand, like both Jesus and Brother Ananias, that regardless of how dangerous the future may seem, the future may be, regardless of how dangerous the ministry assignment may be, that God, there's a will that you are seeking to accomplish, to fulfill, not only in us, but in others. And God, we pray right this moment that you would work on, that you would address, that you would minimize, mitigate, and lessen the fear that we have, and that you would increase the faith. Give us the faith of Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego. It was inevitable, God, that they were going into that fiery furnace. It was inevitable. Give us the faith of Daniel. It was inevitable that he was going in that lion's den. But God, the four of them understood, knew that this ministry assignment wasn't about them. It was about the king's
that they were going to serve, the kings that they were going to minister to. And both Darius and Nebuchadnezzar had a change of heart, had a turnaround. Worship you, God, because of their willingness to walk into the dangerous situation, to walk into the ministry assignment where someone there had murderous intentions. Father God, at some point, someone wants to murder us. And it may not be a physical murdering. It may be a professional murdering. It may be a personal, social murdering. It may be a financial murdering. It may be a spiritual murdering. It may be a political murdering. But someone wants to kill us, God. But the fact, just because they do, do not let that, God, be a reason that keeps us from serving you. Father God, we thank you for everyone who's joined us this morning for prayer here at Inspirational Wednesdays. We pray, God, that as we move from the devotional section to the prayer section of this call, that your Holy Spirit will continue to rest, rule, and abide with us, continue to sympathize us and empathize us so that, God, we have the words, the phrases, the sentences, the paragraphs, the prayers to articulate that raise the concerns, raise the issues your people are dealing with. Father God, you are good. You are great. You are amazing. You are awesome. You are wonderful. You are incredible, God. And God, we thank you for this chance to worship you, to serve you, and to be a part of what you're doing right here on this morning. Father God, it's in your Son's mighty, matchless, marvelous, magnificent name that we do pray. Amen. Amen, everyone. Amen. Praise God. Welcome again to Inspirational Wednesdays. If I did not get a chance to welcome you before, let me welcome you again. Welcome, welcome, welcome. We are so excited that you're here. Amen. We are now, we've had our devotional. Amen. We're going to move from our devotional section into our prayer section, where we get to hear from you, where we get to receive from you your prayer requests, your prayers, your praise reports, your words of encouragement, your testimonies, and your witnesses. Amen. God has done too much. God has blessed us too much. God has shown us too much favor for us not to have at least a praise report. Amen. I know you got some prayer requests, but at least a praise report for all the wonderful things that he has done. Amen. And so we're going to jump right in there. Let me tell you how you raise your prayer requests, prayer, praise report, words of encouragement, testimony, your witness. If you're on the live call, amen. We do have persons on the live call. We are actually on a call here. I'm trying to get my phone around here so you can see it. So the phone number is scrolling by. I want you to see the name of the call, amen, on my phone so you can see. And I want you also to see how much time we've been on here. Amen. You see that? There it is. We're on a live call. So if you're on the call, in a minute or a second, I'm going to turn off the mute function. And when I do, all you have to do is give me your name, where you're calling from, and how it is you want me and want the prayer warriors to pray for you, okay? Now, I understand some of us may be concerned and worried that someone may be on here trying to get our business so they can gossip and spread rumors about us. Well, the devil is a liar. We're not here for that. But if that's what you're worried about, just give us your prayer requests and we will pray with you and for you. If you're on Facebook right now, you're watching on Facebook Live, you can raise your prayer requests too. All you have to do is use the comment box down at the bottom. Type in your prayer requests, whatever it is. Type in your words of encouragement, whatever it is. And then I will raise it for you as if you're on the live call with us. Amen. For those persons who are watching the playback on YouTube, that's right. This call will be on a playback, be available via playback on YouTube later on today. And for those persons who are watching on the playback right now, the question is, what if I have a prayer request and I want to raise a prayer request? You can. This is how you do it. Two ways. If you have Facebook, come on to Facebook, find me. My name is Al Kennon. Last name spelled K-E-N-N-O-N. Go to my Facebook page, click the message button, send me a message with your prayer request, all right? Let's say you don't have Facebook or you're not on social media, but you got email. Send me an email with your prayer request. My email address is Pastor Al Kennon III at gmail.com. That's PastorAlKennonII at gmail.com. Send me the email. When I get the email, when I get the private message, I will pray for you at that moment. So while you're watching right now, you're going to send me the email. It's going to pop up on this phone. Okay? And what I'm going to do, I'm going to stop whatever I'm doing. I'm going to pray for you. I'm going to go into prayer for you right that very instant. But that's not all I'm going to do for you. I'm going to hold that prayer and I'm going to bring it back to the prayer warriors at our next set edition of Inspirational Wednesdays. And I'm going to have the prayer warriors pray for you too. You're going to get double for your trouble. Amen. Praise God. Now, I know someone's saying, wait a second, Pastor Al, that's not fair. How are you giving the people on YouTube double for their trouble, but you're not giving us double for our trouble because we're here? That's because you already got double for your trouble. The word says where two, i.e. double, are gathered in my name, there shall I also be. I'm here. You're here. We've got our prerequisite. And so that means Jesus is right here with us. Now, here's the thing. This is where the double for your trouble comes in, all right? Jesus never shows up by himself. He shows up with his daddy, the Lord God Almighty. He shows up with his blessed Holy Spirit. And the three of them together are right here with us, receiving our prayer requests, writing it down, starting to orchestrate, starting to make things happen so that we will be the recipients of his favor, his grace, his mercy, his love, of his miracles. And the people that we're connected to, they will be the recipients too. So with that said here, let me turn off the mute function. Amen.
All participants are unmuted.
See, now further evidence that we're on the call. If you have a prayer request, praise report, prayer, words of encouragement, testimony, or witness that you would like to raise, like to share, jump in, give us your call. Give us your name, where you're calling from. Not your call. Give us your name, where you're calling from. We'll go from there. If you're on Facebook Live, continue dropping your prayer requests so that we can raise those. Amen. 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 I know it's difficult. I know it's hard. I know you're scared. You're talking into the dark. And by that, I mean you're talking on a phone with, on a call. You don't know who's on there. I get it. This is what I'm going to do. I'm going to raise a prayer request. It's a topic I want to address right quick. And while I'm doing that, you get your prayer requests, your prayers, your words of encouragement, your testimonies, your witnesses, your praise reports together. So that you can raise them after I raise this. All right, so here, this is a prayer request I want to raise. I was talking to a friend, he's a minister, and we were talking in the past 7 days, and we were talking about those persons who are married, who are saved. The one spouse is saved, the other spouse is not. What kind of existence is that for both spouses? Because both spouses are not in the same place spiritually. In fact, my sanctified imagination leads me to believe that for these spouses, life is not as good as it could get. In fact, there is some turmoil, some stress, some drama, some mess that these spouses are experiencing and enduring simply because they're not equally yoked. I mean, think about it. One spouse is believing by faith in the Lord God Almighty. The other spouse is questioning how crazy that the first spouse is because they can't see God, can't hear God, can't feel God, can't taste God, can't smell God. And it doesn't make sense to believe in something that your five senses cannot detect. Here it is, the spouse is saved is expecting a certain type of behavior. The spouse is unsaved is expecting a certain type of behavior. And these expectations are clashing with one another. I know it exists. I've seen it. I'm personally aware of it existing. And what I want to do right now, I want to pray for these couples that both spouses would give their lives to God, that both spouses would be saved, that both spouses would come to know the Lord through the free pardons of their sins, that both spouses would be able to call Christ Jesus their personal Lord and Savior. I know you know someone like that. I know you know a couple like that. We all do. And so guess what? While you putting them on the virtual altar, I've already put them on the virtual altar. I put all these couples on the virtual altar. And I believe by faith that as we are interceding together, touching and agreeing together for these couples, that God is going to do something incredible and amazing. So here, let's go to God in prayer. Dear Father God, creator of the heavens and the earth, God, we come to you right now, God. Thank you for this day, for this is a day that you have made, God. We are glad. We are rejoicing in it. Father God, we come this morning praying for couples, specifically those couples where one spouse is saved and the other is not. God, we don't dare to wonder why that is. Because God, that's digging deep into the minutia. What we are concerned about, what we are worried about is the unequal yoking between the two spouses. For God, those of us who are saved, we desire everyone else to be saved too. Having experienced, having tasted and seen just how good you are, God, it is our desire that others would give themselves to you. And Father God, the other side of the coin is some loved one, some spouse, some husband, some wife is sitting there thinking that we're crazy, sitting there saying to themselves, I will not believe in something I cannot taste, cannot feel, cannot see, cannot smell, cannot hear. That I've gotten this far in my life on my own. I don't need a God like that. I don't need to believe. And so God, there's a tension, there's a conflict, there's a battle of the wills here happening because one spouse is living with the expectation of salvation and the other spouse is not. God, I pray right now that the spouse who is not saved would receive salvation, that they, God, would accept today your son, Jesus, as their personal Lord and Savior, that they would believe in their heart and confess with their mouths that he is Lord to your glory, God. But I'm just not praying for the spouse that's not saved. I'm praying for the spouse that's saved, that he or she would have the patience, the endurance, the love, the sensitivity, the kindness, the meekness, the humility, the gentleness to be an encourager and an empower, so that the spouse that is not saved may confidently make that decision to become saved and to begin walking by faith with the Lord God Almighty. Sometimes, God, we can be cruel and contentious and judgmental and negative toward people when they don't believe, don't think, don't act, don't live as we act, God. God, that's a form of arrogance and pride. And since, God, your devotional series are about humility, help us to deal with that form of arrogance and pride, God. God, I thank you, God, for even bringing these couples together, because, God, there's something that you believe you could accomplish through the couple. That even when, God, they came together because of physical like and lust, you brought them together because you saw further down the road and you knew there was a spiritual objective you could accomplish through them. So, God, put them on one accord. Put them on one faith. Put them according to your one will. So that, God, your kingdom may grow, your kingdom may flourish, your kingdom may be all that you've called it to be. Father God, we love you and we thank you. It's in your Son's mighty, matchless, marvelous, magnificent name that we do pray. Amen. Amen, everyone. Amen. Praise God. You see, it's just that easy. If you have a prayer request, prayer. Someone may just want to pray. You don't have a prayer request. You yourself want to pray. I don't have to be the one praying all the time. I'm just a facilitator, which means is that if you don't have a prayer to pray, I will pray. But if you got a prayer to pray, you can pray too. If you got a praise report, words of encouragement, testimony and witness, and we all should have a testimony and witness, I want you to jump in. I want you to tell us where you're calling from, what it is we can pray for, who it is we can pray for. We'll go over there. In fact, hold on a second. I feel God. He's admonishing me here. We just prayed. I'm coming to you on the phone. Don't hang up. I'm coming to you. We just prayed for couples where one person, one spouse in the couple is not saved, that they get salvation. I feel God saying it's just not couples we need to pray for. It's everyone. In fact, this is what I want to do right now. In the middle of this prayer conference call, I want to offer someone Jesus. Amen. And here's the thing I want you to understand. If you're on this prayer conference call and you're not saved, or you're watching it with someone who is saved, or you're listening, you're overhearing this prayer conference call because someone around you's got it on speaker or got it on the TV and they're listening on TV, and you've been wondering what it is you need to do to be saved. Here's the thing. I need you to understand, first and foremost, that all of us are unworthy of salvation, that this is a gift. As the prophet Isaiah said, all of our righteousness is but filthy rags, and all of us have been like sheep have gone astray. But here's the thing, God proves his love to us that while we were yet sinners, he sent his Son to die for us, that whoever shall believe upon him and confess with their hearts that he is Lord to God's glory shall not die but have eternal life. It's a free gift. You don't have to pay for it. You ain't got that. You ain't got to put no money down on it. You ain't got no mortgage, nothing for it. It's free. And it requires nothing from you than a belief, a sincerity of belief in your heart, and a confession with your mouth. Now, I'm not there at your house. I can't hear your confession. but God can. And that's really the only person, I was going to say the most important, but the only person that really needs to hear your confession. And so let's do this. Let's pray. Amen. Let's pray. We're going to pray. Amen. Because we pray for couples. Well, let's pray for persons that are wrestling with salvation, that are not saved, that are at this moment considering giving themselves to God. Dear Father God, creator of the heavens and earth, thank you, God, for this moment to offer salvation to those who may be looking forward, wrestling with it, thinking about it, considering it. Father God, this is a very important decision. In fact, maybe the most important decision that someone will ever make in their lives. And so, God, we pray that you would dispatch your Holy Spirit at this very moment. Send your Holy Spirit on assignment with purpose, with an objective to come down and minister to these persons so that they would freely give themselves to you. They will freely accept your Son, Christ Jesus, as their personal Lord and Savior, and that they will freely begin walking with you by faith in this thing called life, called ministry, called purpose, God, called love. God, thank you for who you're saving. Thank you for who you're claiming. Thank you for expanding and growing the kingdom. And God, we pray that you'll be with them all the days of their lives, that you'll great raise them up, that you'll mature them, that you'll grow them into faith-wielding, faith-possessing, faith-utilizing disciples and stewards that bring you honor and glory with their own service, with their own walk, with their own ministry. And when it's said and done, God, you'll come and get us all, and that you'll take us back to heaven where we will be able to spend eternity with you, worshiping you, exalting you for being the awesome, incredible, amazing God that you are. Father God, we love you and we thank you. It's in your Son's mighty, matchless, marvelous, magnificent name that we do pray. Let me do this. I'm getting ready to ask for a prayer request from the phone, but let me just remind people, because I get your mind on Sunday mornings. If you accepted Christ for the very first time today during this call, remember I gave at the beginning of the call my email address, and I told you who I am on Facebook, so you can send me a private message. I want you to send me a private message, an email, saying that you've accepted Christ for the very first time today. Again, my name is Al Kennon, K-E-N-N-O-N. I'm on Facebook. Amen. My email address is PastorAlKennon3@gmail.com. PastorAlKennonIII@gmail.com. Send me that private message, that email, and I will walk with you. Amen. We don't birth babies in the natural and put them in a corner and say, raise yourself. We nurture them. We care for them. We grow them until they become self-sufficient, self-sustaining adults. Same thing in spirits. God doesn't birth babies in the spirit and put them in the corner to grow up. We walk with you. We nurture you. We help you grow until you mature into your own Christian disciple and steward. Amen. So, amen. Now that we've done that, let's open up the floor again. If you have a prayer request, praise report, prayer, word of encouragement, testimony, witness you'd like to share in your own the phone, jump in, give us your name, where you're calling from, and how it is we can pray with you and for you. Amen. Amen. I had to wet my whistle. Amen. Y'all don't understand. This talking. Amen. It takes a lot out of you. Amen. Praise God. I saw some prayer requests online. We've got folks online who are dropping their prayer requests. Amen. Good morning, Sister Liza. Good morning, Sister Yvonne. Good morning, Brother Kevin. Amen. Good morning. Amen. Where was I? Saw it. I scrolled it past it. Okay. Amen. Amen. Good morning, Sister Gail. Amen. Good morning, Sister Lena. Amen. Where is it? There it is. Okay. Good morning, Sister Evangelist Yasmin. Amen. Good morning. It's all right. It's okay for joining us when you join us. Okay, Sister Yvonne, amen, has shared that her mother, she said, mommy turned 89 yesterday. Hallelujah, praise God.
That is an awesome testimony. That's a praise report, y'all. Because guess what? People are leaving here every day. In fact, just before we came on this call, one of my frat brothers had posted to his page that Andre Bauer, amen, the actor, y'all know who I'm talking about, that he died between yesterday and this morning. I think sometime last night he died. I'm sure yesterday when he lay down or he retired or whatever he's doing, he said, I'll do that tomorrow. And he's no longer here, y'all. Let us not ever be so naive and arrogant to think that we will always be around, that we aren't subject to death. Every day, death haunts us. Death is a predator that stalks us every single day. It's only by the grace of God that death does not make us its latest prey. And so we are celebrating mommy's birthday, Sister Yvonne, that she turned 89. We are celebrating that. We're praising God. And this is what we want to do. Amen. Praise God. Because I know there are persons on this call connected to us that are having birthdays or will have a birthday coming up soon. Amen. Praise God. All us mighty Sagittariuses are having birthdays right now. And regardless of how old you're going to be, I don't care if you're turning 1 year old or you're turning 101 years old, we are celebrating you. And we're going, let's offer God a prayer of praise for keeping and blessing Sister Yvonne's mother and Sister Yvonne and everybody else who's having birthdays this year. Amen. Because guess what? You didn't have to have a birthday. Let's just be honest with you. You really did. But the God you serve is so faithful that he made sure that you had a birthday to celebrate. So here, let's go to God in prayer of praise. God, Father God, creator of the heavens and the earth, we thank you, God, at this moment for your goodness and your faithfulness, for loving us as you have, for God, thinking it not robbery to bring us again to another birthday. God, 365 days have passed since the last time we had a birthday, and anything during that time could have happened. Things happen within a blink of an eye, within a second. And here it is, you kept us for that many seconds, that many minutes, that many hours, that many days, that many weeks, that many months. Father God, you deserve a praise shout. You deserve a praise party. You deserve all the honor and the glory, because God, your keeping ability has been marvelous, has been incredible, has been wonderful, has been amazing. That God, you have done something spectacular for us. Father God, I celebrate you, God. I love you, God. I thank you, God, for keeping Sister Yvonne's mother. You didn't have to, but you did. And in keeping her mother, you didn't just bless her mother, but you blessed Sister Yvonne and her siblings, and you bless us, because guess what? By keeping her mother, you've kept Sister Yvonne in a place where she can do ministry, and in doing ministry, she has blessed us. Father God, thank you for everyone that you've looked out for, you've kept, you've blessed. You didn't have to do it, but you did. And so we thank you, God. Father God, we also killed that thought that the devil was trying to put in someone's head who lost someone who didn't see a birthday. Just because they didn't see a birthday doesn't mean you didn't keep them. Doesn't mean you didn't love them, didn't cherish them. It just means, God, that you decided in your infinite wisdom that it was time for those persons to come home, to come to heaven, to spend time with you, to be with you, God. The devil is a liar. And God, all that you love, you do love indeed. And God, whether or not we see a birthday,
or any more birthdays, it doesn't change the fact that you love us and that you'll never leave us nor you forsake us. So, God, we thank you, we praise you, we honor you, we glorify you. It's in your Son's mighty, matchless, marvelous, and magnificent name that we do pray. Amen. Amen. Good morning, Bishop Brian. It's so good to see you. Good, so good to see you. Sister Lena Davis is asking for prayers for her daughter, Tashia. I hope I'm pronouncing that name right. Tashia. It looks like Tashia. She needs a house to live in. She also wants us to keep her in prayer for God's will to be done for total healing in her eyes. Amen. Sister Lena, you ain't asked for much. You really ain't asked for much. Because let me tell you something. There's a couple stories in the Bible where either Jesus or God's prophets or servants, enable blind people to see. There's the two blind men sitting outside of on the street, outside of Jericho on the street. There's blind Bartimaeus. There's a blind man that the people brought to Jesus. But these people were blind. They could not see. And God enabled them to see. So, Selena, you can see right now. So he can enable blind persons to see. You don't think he can't enable someone that can't see to continue to see, to heal your eyes? So it's not, I believe God is going to do it just to show folks what he's capable of. And while he's blessing you with healing, I believe my God is going to provide your daughter with the housing arrangement she needs. Because God's will is that we would be blessed, be highly favored. God's will, he says it. He says that we would have a future. That he has given us a future. That we would be lenders and not borrowers. That we'd be the head and not the tail. That he wants us to thrive. And so, we're going to pray for Sister Lena at this moment. Amen. Praise God. But if there's someone else that's in a life situation, we want you to put their names on our virtual altar. In fact, this is what I want you to do. And God just dropped it in my spirit. I saw something. And I'm hoping it's not what I think it is. But I saw Bishop Alexander had earpieces in. I happened to be watching one afternoon a playback of a service where Bishop Walter Scott Thomas Sr. had come to preach University Park's 111th church anniversary. And when Bishop got up to speak, you could see he was wearing earpieces. I'm hoping and praying there's nothing wrong, but if there is, I'm touching and agreeing that God would heal his ears. Because how can Bishop preach if he can't hear what God is saying to him? So I want you to take this moment. Again, it is someone that fits the bill. Put them on our virtual altar as we go to God in prayer here. Let us go to God in prayer. Dear Father God, creator of the heavens and the earth, God, we come to you right now thanking you, God, for all the great, wonderful things that you are to us, the wonderful ways, the wonderful God that you are to us, and the wonderful things that you do for us. For God, we're only here today able to lift up these prayer requests because, God, you have enabled us to be here in the first place. Father God, Sister Lena has dropped on the virtual altar some prayer requests. She's praying for her daughter, Tashia needs housing, God. She needs a place that she can call home, a place she can rest her head, a place she can kick her feet up, a place she can retreat to, God, and spend time in prayer at, a place, God, that she can call her own. And there's different forms of housing that you can give her. God, we're not saying one or over the other. God, we're saying in your infinite wisdom, bless her with the housing that she can handle, that she needs, so that, God, she's out of the elements. Do it, God, so that she gives your name all the glory, the honor, and the praise it so richly deserves. God, we pray for Sister Lena herself. She's saying she has a problem with her eyes. She didn't say what's wrong with her eyes, but she's asking for healing in her eyes. So God, we pray right this moment, right this instant, God, that you would bless her with healing in her eyes. God, if you've been able to open the eyes of blind persons, this is nothing. You can knock this out in a twinkling of an eye, in the mere passing of a second, that God, you could heal Sister Lena so that, God, she's able to see perfectly, completely, and wholly. Father God, we pray for Bishop Alexander. God, we pray, hope and pray that we are wrong, that our discernment is off. But if it is not, God, and if there is some kind of issue with his hearing, God, we pray, God, that you would literally touch his ears. That, God, you would speak to his ears, that you would minister to his ears so that, God, they would be healed. So that he can hear everything and hear everything clearly. We want his auditory sensories to be working at 220% so that when it's time to hear from you, God, he can hear from you. Father God, it's just not Bishop Alexander and Sister Lena that we're praying for. We're praying for everyone, God. Everyone that is in a situation where they need healing in their bodies, healing in their spirits, healing in their minds, healing in their persons, healing in their lives, healing in the lives of those persons connected to them. Healing is what they need. And God, we pray that you would be a healer, that you would be Jehovah Rapha. God, we pray that you would do that and so much more. It's in your son's mighty, matchless, marvelous, magnificent name we do pray. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Amen. Amen. If there's anyone on the call and you want to raise your prayer request, prayer, words of encouragement, testimony, or witness, or praise report, jump in, give us your name, where you're calling from, and we will go from there. Amen.
Good morning, Pastor Al.
Good.
In Michigan.
Hey, how you doing, sis?
I'm doing well. Good to hear your voice this morning. That was your own today.
Amen. It's good to hear your voice too. How can we pray for you?
Yes, I would like to start with a praise report. We prayed for my mom a couple of weeks ago. She had surgery on her heart.
Uh huh.
She was the perfect child. If you had a poster child, everything going perfectly, she was dead. Everything okay. Went well.
Amen.
She was home by the end of the day, and then she was up and doing her thing. So I just
Amen.
COVID thought he was going to take her out, and she's been having like long COVID, but she's still here, and she's doing well. So praise God for that.
Amen.
I also ask you all to pray for our Thanksgiving time with my sister is a cousin's aunt, and it was a wonderful, peaceful weekend, and we really just enjoyed one another.
Amen.
And I don't take that for granted. I know, like, many people say, oh, I don't talk to my sister, and I look at them like they're deer in headlights. I'm like, I can't imagine not talking to my sister.
Right.
And so I'm grateful for the relationships I have with my family, so I praise God for that. For prayer, I've just noticed, like, a couple of interactions with folks. I don't know if this is time for when a break, or people are not hear me, or I'm not speaking in a way that's loving and kindness. And I just want to pray that my communication is clear, and that
amen.
That I don't want to hurt people's feelings. I want to speak the truth in love.
Okay.
That's my prayer, just to speak the truth and speak the truth in love.
Amen.
And I'm asking for prayer for the Pontiac United Education Coalition, the Pontiac Reads, and We Love Lit. I just feel like this space with just when Black people are leading nonprofits, and we kind of have the expertise, I feel like it just intimidates those that are in this space as well.
Right.
That they kind of block us from doing the work that we're actually doing. So we're not just talking about it, we're actually doing it. I feel like we're at war. We're at war making sure that our kids get the literacy skills that they need.
Right.
When Dr. African came to speak to our families, he was saying it's going to take if we keep this rate and celebrate this 1% that some of our school districts do, it's going to take us 1,000 years. For our kids to get to 70% proficient.
Right. Wow. 1,000 years.
Those are my prayers.
Okay. Amen. And these are some great prayer requests. Amen. Amen. And let me say this. The 1,000 years is a long time. But the God we serve is able to exponentially increase that, so that it doesn't take 1,000 years. In fact, we serve a God that's able to give us the resources, the talent, the manpower, the woman power necessary to change the literary skills and the literary proficiency of our children. And so all we have to do is to believe by faith, to trust by faith that God can do it and he'll do it. Amen. And I'm so excited and ecstatic to hear that Mama is doing well. Because I remember Mama at your birthday party. And boy, she was a handful then. So amen. Praise God. Amen. Let's do this. If you got a prayer request similar to that Dr. Ashlyn has raised on our call, why don't you put it on our virtual altar as we go to God in prayer. Here, let us pray. Dear Father God, creator of the heavens and the earth, God, we thank you for this day, for this is a day that you have made, God. We are glad, we are rejoicing in it. Father God, we are praising you right now for Sister Sylvia, that God, you didn't have to protect her and keep her as you did, that you could have said, I've done enough. But God, you thought it not robbery to sit there in that operating room and to be an additional attending physician to ensure that our mother, our sister, our aunt, our neighbor, our cousin, our church member, that she came through with flying colors, and that God, you were able to send her home and able to restore her to the point that she's up and moving around. God, you are good. You are awesome. You are faithful. You are incredible. God, we know that what you've done is just the latest of all the things you're doing for. And God, we pray that it will not be the last. That God, it would just be the latest of many more things you're going to do for Sister Sylvia. God, we pray
that you keep your hands upon her, continue to heal her, continue to be with her, continue to love on her, God, the way that you are. God, thank you for a peaceful Thanksgiving holiday. Thank you for allowing Sister Ashlyn to be able to go spend time with her family, her sisters, her aunts, her mother, and all others. And God, as awesome as Thanksgiving was, God, Christmas is coming up. And so, God, we pray that you're already ahead of us into our Christmas, anointing that time and anointing that space and that place so that we have an enjoyable, blessed, loving time with family. Family, God, we pray right now for those persons who may not have loved ones here with them. We pray that, God, we are sensitive enough to your spirit, loving enough to open up our homes and invite people to come in and be part of what is going on so that no one has to spend Christmas by themselves. Father God, we pray for Sister Ashlyn and all others who, God, really want and really desire to be able to speak the truth in love. You know, sometimes, God, this life, this world beats us up, mistreats us so that, God, what happens is that we get bitter, we get edgy, we get mean, we get sharp-tongued. We don't mean to, it's just what happens. Well, God, we are praying right now that, God, you would help us, speak to us, minister to us, so that when we speak in love. That when we speak calmly and gently and kindly and meekly and humbly. So that someone is edified, equipped, and encouraged and empowered after speaking with us. Even if they were wrong, they're still edified, encouraged, empowered, and equipped after speaking with us. God, we pray for the Pontiac Educational Coalition for We Love Lit and all other nonprofits that are working their butts off to provide the literary enrichment to our babies, our children, so that, God, they are literally proficient in terms of their reading, their writing, and their math. Father God, we don't want you to spend 1,000 years doing this. We want you to do it quick, fast, and in a hurry. We want you to do this now because, God, we cannot stand to suffer any longer. Our kids cannot stand to suffer any longer. Our families cannot stand to suffer any longer. Our communities cannot stand to suffer any longer. Oh, this world cannot stand to suffer any longer. Help us become literally become proficient literacy wise. God, do that so that, God, we may praise you and honor you and exalt you, God. God, if there was anyone else on this call that had a prayer request like Sister Ashlyn, God, we pray, God, that you would answer it quick, fast, in a hurry so that you, so that they may lift you up in praise. They may glorify you and honor you and exalt you, God. God, we thank you and we love you. It's in your Son's mighty, matchless, marvelous, magnificent name that we do pray. Amen. Amen, everybody. Amen. Praise God. Sister Ashlyn, thank you for the prayer request. Amen. Let me do this. Amen. If there's anybody else on the call that I'd like to lift up a prayer request, praise report, prayer, words of encouragement, testimony, witness, jump in, give us your name, where you're calling from, and we'll go from there.
Somebody else, a family playing on my heart. I met them in a parking lot yesterday.
Okay.
And mom had 3 kids. Her name was Michelle, and she said, right now we're living in the shelter. And I just happened to be in the parking lot, and the mother waved at me. And I was like, she would be the perfect size for these pajamas I had in my car. And he put, so I was able to gift that for them. But it just been on my heart.
Okay.
This morning, so Michelle and her 3 kids.
Amen. Praise God. That's good. That's a great thing that God is placing on your heart, because what he's trying to get us to realize is that there's always a need for prayer and there's always a need for service. And we are praising God that he was able to use you yesterday. And we're going to touch and agree with you right now, because it's not just Michelle and her kid, three kids. It's a whole lot of people that are dealing with homelessness right now. So here, let us go to God in prayer for that. I'm putting everyone that is homeless on the virtual altar for this prayer. Dear Father God, creator of the heavens and the earth, we thank you for this day, for this is a day that you have made, God. We are glad, we are rejoicing in it. Father God, we pray for the homeless. We pray for those persons, God, who are living on the street, under bridges, in down in the ditches, in the sewers, valleys, in between rolling hills, God, that are forced to be out there in the elements, God. God, it's wintertime and it is bitter cold, and there are children, babies that are forced to live on the street. God, my heart goes out to them. And God, it should impact, it should touch every single one of us when we think about those people living on the street. Not just adults, but babies. God, makes us extra thankful for the blessing that you've given us. It makes us extra thankful that, God, you have literally opened up the windows of heaven and blessed us with some kind of housing. It may not be the mansion on the lake that we want, but God, we're outside of the elements. God, we pray right now that shelters will be available, that God, you would provide affordable housing, that God, you will open up housing options for Sister Michelle and her three kids, as well as other homeless persons, so that God, they don't have to live on the street. They got to be out here in the elements. They can live their lives, God. God, we pray this prayer in your son's mighty, matchless, marvelous, magnificent name that we do pray. Amen. 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 Thank you, Sister Ashlyn, for that additional prayer. We are going to touch and agree. We're going to believe that God is going to do something awesome, incredible, and wonderful for Sister Michelle and her three kids. Amen. 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 Sister Gail is asking, Gail from Yonkers. Amen. I got saved from Yonkers. Amen. And that's my girl. She's asking that we pray for her, for her son Teddy, her daughter Shamika. Pray for healing, strength, peace, and forgiveness for the three of them. Pray for her family, for Rich and Carol, for Betsy, Judy, Maria, Rosie. She wants us to pray for the homeless. We just did, but we'll continue to pray for the jobless, for the grieving, for the elderly, for those in a hospital or nursing home, for the ministry team, for the grief support group with Pastor Carol, for the prayer list and call, for the war going on, and for everyone everywhere. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Sister Yvonne is asking that we continue to pray for Reverend Marion German. Amen. Reverend German has cancer. We're praying for complete healing. She wants us to continue to pray for her, as well as her family and her church family. Amen. Trying to see my prayer requests. Okay. All right. Okay. Amen. And so I have a couple more prayer requests, because we're going to raise them in all in one big omnibus prayer. Amen. My girl, one of my besties. Amen. Dr. Suzanne Smith has asked that, first of all, she gave us a praise report that all her prayers from last week, her list last week, were answered. Amen. Praise God. She wants us to pray for her mother, Sue, that her stomach is completely healed with no more nausea. She wants us to continue to pray healing from RSV for baby Stormy Litford, that God would normalize her heart rate, her temperature, and her breathing. Amen. that she would receive the breakthrough she prayed for before the end of the year, that God would bless her father Daryl's finances tremendously. She also wants us to pray that God would heal baby Stormy of a UTI. She is improving. They've lowered her oxygen and she's eating. She has a fever again, and they believe it's the urinary tract infection. So we're praying for that little bitty baby, that God would do a blessing in her life. Sister Vita Harrell wants us to pray for her daughter, Ayana, as she takes her final exam today at 3 p.m. Safe travels for Ayana. She travels home to Georgia after she completes that exam. She wants us to pray that God will cover her mother, Minnie Clyburn, to get her blood pressure and diabetes under control, and that she prayed that God would bless her aunt Ann Brewer to find a place to stay by the end of the year, as well as an unspoken prayer request. Amen. Those are our prayer requests that we have today. We're going to have one last prayer request before we close out and get busy enjoying this day that the Lord has made. Here, let us touch and agree. If there's anything that you need prayer for, put it on our virtual altar. Just because I didn't call it out doesn't mean this prayer is not going to cover it. But if you don't say it, if you don't put it on the altar, then God can't do it. The word says, you have not because you ask not. You never find because you never seek. The door is never open for you because you never knock. You've got to take the first step. Put it on our virtual altar. Trust God. Go for it. All right? Here, let us go to God in prayer. Dear Father God, creator of the heavens and the earth, God, we thank you and praise you. For this is a day that you have made. We are glad. We are rejoicing in it. Father God, your people have a wide assortment of prayer requests, that each of us are dealing with something differently. And God, regardless of the fact that we're each dealing with something differently, the truth is, whatever we're dealing with is impacting us negatively. It's seeking to hinder our praise. It's seeking to stop our forward progress. It's seeking to keep us from serving you in ministry, whatever that ministry is. And Father God, we declare right now the devil is a liar. That God, the forces that are coming against us, God, will not stop us from magnifying your name, for glorifying you in front of others and before others, and serving others in accordance with your will. God, I pray right now healing for whoever needs healing. I pray restoration for whoever needs restoration. I pray employment for whoever needs employment. I pray housing for whoever needs housing. I pray reconciliation for whoever needs reconciliation. I pray that God, I pray hope for someone who's feeling hopeless. I pray love for someone who's feeling unloved. I pray freedom for someone who feels enslaved and entrapped. I pray a sense of self-esteem, a sense of self-worth for someone who feels like they have no self-esteem, they have no self-worth. I pray companionship for someone who feels lonely. Whatever it is, God, I pray, God, that you would address it so that these persons will be fortified, strengthened, empowered, and encouraged to serve you, God, how you have called them to serve you, so that, God, not only you glorify, but they help lead someone else to you, God, through the free pardons of their sins. Father God, I thank you and I love you, God, and I pray, God, that you continue to be a part of all of our lives, and God, that you would do what only you could do in these persons' lives. Now, God, work it out, make it happen, transform, transmogrify. God, just renew, restore, rebuild, reform, recreate. God, do whatever it is you need to do so that, God, we may be able to praise you as one chorus, one choir for all the great, wonderful things you have done. It's in your Son's mighty, matchless, marvelous, magnificent name that we do pray. Amen. Amen, everyone. Amen. Again, we want to thank you for joining us for another session, another edition of Inspirational Wednesdays. My name is Pastor Al. It's been a pleasure. It's been a privilege to be here with you today, to be able to serve you in this ministry of prayer. We pray that God has spoken to you, God has edified you, God has educated you, God has empowered you, God has equipped you, God has enabled you, God has encouraged you, God has done whatever he needs to do to help you be the disciple and steward that he's called you to be for today. So with that said, let us have our closing word of prayer. Then we're going to get busy enjoying this day, doing what God has called us to do at this time. It's in. All right. So here, let us go to God in prayer. Dear Father God, thank you for loving us as you have. Thank you for showering us as you have. God, we thank you even for Sister Liza's prayer request, for Deborah Adams, for healing, for stage 4 cancer, for Jerice Brinkling, for healing for her grandchildren, and Luzina, grief over the loss of her son. That God, even now in a closing prayer, you are blessing us with your anointing, with your favor, with your presence, God. That God, you are showering us with your favor, God. That you're opening up the window of heavens and pouring out blessings, power, and authority for us, God. God, I pray right now that, God, this time spent together would not have been time spent in vain, that it's been productive time, good time. It's been time where persons have been able to come and experience you, God, in the fullness of your grace and mercy. God, I pray right now that you've been glorified, honored, and praised, God. And I pray, God, that, God, you would strengthen us, fortify us, so that we may continue to serve you as you see fit. Father God, we're going to bring this prayer conference call to an end, but God, we pray that we would never bring our relationship with you to an end, that, God, you will be present with us at all times. Father God, we love you, and we thank you, God. We honor you and praise you. It's in your Son's mighty, matchless, marvelous, magnificent name that we do pray. Amen. Amen, everyone. Amen. Please have a blessed day. We will pray with you again, probably in the new year. Amen. Because next week is the day after my birthday. And then after that is the Wednesday after Christmas. So it'll be in the new year when we pray with you. But please don't stop praying in between now and then, all right? Keep praying, keep trusting God, and he'll keep showering you with his favor, his presence, and his anointing. I love you. Have a blessed day. Bye-bye.